stuck in a wheelchair for 22 years.
Where do I go from here?
One woman takes a last leap of faith.
I said I kept feeling something in my legs.
Witness a miracle.
Are you willing to risk your pride, even if you fall?
On today's 700 Club Interactive. Hi, and welcome to the show. You are about to see a miracle. Dahlia Knox spent more than two decades confined to a wheelchair. She couldn't feel her legs, couldn't feel her feet. Walking, that was out of the question. At least until Dahlia went to a revival service. And what happened there has been seen around the world.
There's a whole lot that I don't recall specifically, but I know this. The car vehicle was upside down and they were trying to get me out. And there was music playing in my head.
On a snowy Christmas day in 1987, Dahlia Knox was in a car with her sister and brother-in-law when they were hit by a drunk driver.
I was semi-conscious, then I went unconscious. And so then I woke up in the hospital.
Although the others escaped with minor injuries, the crash left Dahlia paralyzed from the waist down. Doctors told her she would likely be confined to a wheelchair the rest of her life.
From there on, I went through, like, what do I do from here now? Where do I go from here?
Dahlia was determined to live her life. An accomplished gospel singer, she continued her work in music ministry, but her life was hard.
I would continue to go and sing, and I would push myself, you know, into the restroom or the shower, whatever, and then I would drag myself into the car, and I would push myself. It was one of those things where you had to drag yourself, you had to push yourself.
Dahlia believed God would heal her as people prayed constantly for her. But after a decade passed with no changes, she started to lose hope.
I didn't like going to altar calls because every time I would go somewhere, the service would change to a healing service and somebody would try to pull me out of the chair. And I've been plopped, dropped, flopped, and flipped, and, you know, to the point where I was like, I just can't go through that anymore.
While attending a Christian conference, she was captivated by one of the speakers, Bishop Levy Knox.
It was so amazing because he didn't see the wheelchair. He saw beyond the wheelchair.
He later became her husband and a major source of inspiration for Dahlia.
I remember him taking me in front of the mirror at home and holding me up and just say, I want you to see yourself standing. He would take me and dance with me and just, you know, as my legs would dangle, he would take me around. And he was one that always continuously tried to put hope and faith in me as to think beyond that, even though at times I was frustrated about it.
By 2010, Dahlia had been in a wheelchair for over 22 years. In August, she and her husband attended a conference hosted by evangelist Nathan Morris.
The evangelist went up and he started speaking on healing and all that. Had I known it was a healing service, I have to be honest, I would have never gone.
She was at the front of the church with her husband when Pastor Morris started praying for her.
Here I am confined for 22 and a half years in this wheelchair. And for the first time in the longest time, I find myself that something could possibly really be happening. I said, I'm feeling something in my legs.
The power of God is all over this sister right now. She normally has no feelings, but she can feel our hands on her legs. And she's had no feelings.
I had to get to the heart of it. And the heart of it was, are you willing to risk your pride and take a step of faith, even if you fall?
With the assistance of her husband, Dahlia slowly rose. She later stumbled and sat back down, fighting to block out the doubts flooding her mind.
I remember the words that he prayed were, let faith arise in this woman of God. In Hebrews 11, faith is in the present, in the now. It's standing between two present terms. Now, faith is. And I sat there and a righteous indignation came in me. A righteous anger came in me. I just said, just worship, because I wanted to drown everything that was going out. I just worship.
Then her husband and Pastor Morris helped her back on her feet. She took a few steps on her own. Then, as the congregation sang and prayed, Dahlia started walking around the church.
Paraplegics will tell you that you can move on your hips. And so I thought, was I moving on my hips? I just started moving my knees up and down, and I started bouncing on my knees. It was like the awakening. This is really happening.
She began to take those steps and began to walk. It was like the word that had already been spoken, beholding the word, hearing the word, and now the manifestation of the promises of God was being fulfilled right before our eyes. It was phenomenal. It was life-changing for us.
Over the following week, she says God began to strengthen her legs. 3 weeks later, she walked in front of her own congregation for the first time. Today, Dahlia leads worship at Living Word Christian Church in Mobile, where her husband is the pastor. She also dances with him every chance she gets.
The miracle is the journey, is not the moment. It's the journey of recognizing who God is. If He would have never healed me, I would still be pushing through to get into His face. Because it's not about the healing, it's about the journey of knowing that God is there for us.
What a beautiful couple, the Knox family, and we rejoice in what God did in their lives. And you heard Dahlia, for a while she was kind of over seeking the healing. She didn't want to go to healing services. She didn't even want to be around certain services at all, in fear it would turn into her becoming a spectacle. And maybe you're at a point where you're waiting on God for a miracle. You've been praying and praying and praying, and you're not seeing the promise fulfilled. We want to pray with you now for that situation. In fact, Jessica's over in our chat room seeing prayer requests coming in. And Jessica, you can identify with this story, can't you?
I can, Andrew. And, you know, so often when we've gone up for prayer and, you know, we've had disappointments in the past, it can really put a fear of more disappointment. You know, is God going to show up for me? And I can personally relate to that. I went through a season of my life where I was pressing in for a very long time for healing. And I would go up and nothing would happen. And something that her husband said in that testimony was that she took hold of the word that had already been spoken over her. And that's the difference of having a word that's head knowledge, you know, by His wounds we are healed, to a word that becomes a rhema, a word that becomes transforming, where we actually take it. And we say, God, that word is for me. I now have the faith to be able to appropriate this word in my life. And that's what happened to me. And that's what happened in the story you just saw. And if you're watching and you've been pressing in for a healing and you're saying, God, I'm just scared. I am going to get disappointed. I have been disappointed so many times. We just challenge you. Step out today. Take a risk. Even if you don't see an immediate healing, start praising Him, just like she said that she would just keep praising. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank You so much, God. Lord, that even when we don't see a change in the symptoms, we can still stand on Your word that says, by Your wounds, we are healed. And as an exercise of faith, we say, Jesus, thank You. Thank You that when You died on the cross, the word for salvation is sozo, which means saved, healed, delivered. It means that we can receive not just Your salvation, but Your deliverance and Your healing. Father, we thank You that symptoms are a lie and that the truth of the word is that You have overcome sickness and the grave. So, Lord, we receive by faith right now, even over what the doctors are saying, that You are the great physician. And for those who are watching and you're saying, I believe this word is for me, take it now. Receive your healing today. Even if the symptoms don't go away right just immediately, just say, you know what, God, Your word is stronger than symptoms. And every day I will praise You. And every day I will declare Your word over my body and over my life because You are faithful. Andrew?
There are many watching this program who are confined to beds and are undergoing extreme pain and seeking a healing. And it's no accident you're watching this program. The Holy Spirit says, I hear you, I see you, I'm with you. This is a day to restore relationship with God for those who feel He is no longer in control. He's in control. Father, we thank You for Your healing power. We thank You for giving us the Holy Spirit to lead us, guide us, heal us. There are many watching who say, it's my marriage that's broken. And they see that the couple, the Knox couple, and they say, I want that kind of love in my marriage. It's my marriage that's crumbled and needs healing. And our Heavenly Father says, I am in the midst of your problems in your marriage. I hear your cries. And Father, we pray for those marriages now in Jesus' name for restoration and peace and healing. And Father, we thank you for listening. We thank you for being with us. Jesus, we thank you for your sacrifice on the cross. And Father God, we thank you for raising Jesus from the grave, that power is still at work today in Jesus' name. Amen. If you'd like somebody to pray with you, give us a call, 888-777-1999. We are always here ready to pray for you. Well, still ahead, a brutal beating left this woman deaf until a modern-day miracle caused her to hear again. Stay with us. The telephone ringing, grandchildren playing, and the songs and sermons in church. These are the simple sounds that Nathy loves to hear. But at one time, her world was almost silent for 3 decades.
30 years ago, Nathy was brutally beaten. The last sound she heard was a loud slap.
A group of villagers attacked me like an angry mob. They wanted our property. They beat me, hit me in the head, and left me to die.
Nathi's spine and head were severely damaged. She was temporarily paralyzed from the waist down and couldn't hear. She was eventually able to walk again, but she still had a difficult time hearing.
I had to shout into her ear several times before she could understand me.
I felt so alone. It was very hard to keep in touch with my daughters, who are married and live in another village. When they called me on the phone, I couldn't even hear it ring.
Nathi and her husband are Christians.
I prayed to Jesus and told him that no matter if I receive a miracle or not, I would continue to believe in him and trust him until I die.
Nathi's prayers were answered when a CBN medical clinic came to her village. She was told she needed a pair of hearing aids. When they were placed in her ears for the very first time, Nathi couldn't believe what she could hear.
I could hear every little sound clearly when the doctor was testing me. Out of habit, my husband was shouting in my ear to give me instructions. I told him that he was too loud and he had to learn to speak to me in a normal voice. Once I got home, I was so excited. It was so wonderful to hear my grandchildren and the rest of my family. I could hear the phone ring and I could talk to our daughters.
Hallelujah!
In church, I can hear the sermon, songs and testimonies. I'm able to listen to people and pray for them.
I thank CBN for helping my wife hear again after 30 years. She has become a testimony in our village and continues to bring God glory.
I thank God and you for providing me with the hearing aids.
30 years, Nathi couldn't hear like you and me. But thanks to you, we made it possible here at CBN to help her in that village, living a, frankly, a lonely life and a life she didn't deserve. But thanks to you, we made a difference. It's real easy to do. Just give us a call at 888-777-1999, or you can log on to 700clubinteractive.com, and you can participate in what we're doing around the world. We're talking about healing today, and if you join with us, we will send you this Be Healed DVD. It's a great instrument to show you how Jesus healed and how Jesus is still at work here today in healing broken lives. Partner with us here at CBN. Well, coming up, a snorkeler in a battle with Jaws.
I felt a tremendous blast to my calf and was like an electrical charge almost to my leg. When I looked back, I saw the shark sort of shake as it was pulling a piece of my leg off.
Stay with us. Watch how this man's family responds as they help in the fight for his life. You don't want to miss it. Stay with us. All right, listen to this. You may have trouble believing it, but it's true. Eric Norrie has been struck by lightning, bitten by a rattlesnake, and punched by monkeys twice. The UK Daily Mail called him the world's unluckiest man after Eric went snorkeling and he was attacked by a shark.
The water is my life. I'm always on the water, at least 50% of my life.
I knew something was wrong because I thought I had heard him say shark.
We're in the Bahamas on vacation and we went out snorkeling in the morning. And then we went to just a little cove that was like 5 feet deep and all sand.
Everybody was sort of doing their own thing, and I decided to go into the water with my spear. I speared a grouper and was heading back to the boat with it, but I'd gotten over the sandbar and was in really shallow water, so at that point in time it was like I was home free. Never saw it coming. Just all of a sudden, next thing I know, I felt a tremendous blast to my calf and was like an electrical charge almost to my leg, and then you could literally hear like the ripping sound underwater of your flesh being ripped. When I looked back, I saw the shark sort of shake as it was pulling a piece of my leg off and swimming away. I remember initially screaming.
I couldn't tell if he had a leg or didn't. I could just see red and blood and him pulling on rocks.
I feel like the Eric Norrie switch turned off, and God just gave me a tremendous clarity. After I had tied the tourniquet above my knee, I just threw the spear in the fish in hopes that he wouldn't come back at me. There was a 10 to 12 foot radius of just solid crimson around me, so I was just in a pool, literally, of blood. At this point in time, my father-in-law stood in between me and the shark while I got into the boat. And then I slung my leg up on the bait well and tied another tourniquet on below my knee. And my mother-in-law started wrapping my leg with towels. And
I didn't think he was gonna live. And my body kind of went into shock. I couldn't breathe and I couldn't move.
I just went and like sort of put my head on his chest and kept telling him, "You're gonna be okay, honey. The Lord's with you. You're gonna be okay. I know you're gonna be okay." I wanted the girls to not see anything as much as I could protect them from seeing him. I had gone to the three younger girls on the boat and said, "I want you guys to look out at the water and I need you to just start praying, just praying." I told them, "God's already holding on to Daddy and he will keep holding him, but you have to pray." Kayla went, she grabbed Eric's phone so that she had all of his contacts and she called some of his closest friends right away and said, "My dad's been attacked by a shark." And then she said, "I need people to pray." And so then prayer chains started going out.
My daughter had called out on the radio and we'd been picked up by another boat that was close by that had a neonatal trauma doctor aboard.
She was saying how, "Eric, you've really lost a lot of blood. I need you to try to be still." He was really in a lot of pain and arching his back a lot.
And I remember thinking, this is how I'm gonna die. I just started praying and just thanking God for what was happening.
Eric just started saying, first sort of quietly, thank you, Lord. And then it got louder till he was like yelling, thank you, Lord. And then he just kind of went silent. And I felt a little scared and unsure of what was happening.
And I don't know why I started doing that. He just gave me a total peace right then. It was incredible. In the trauma center in the Bahamas, I remember being in the room and at times being in extreme pain. I remember bits and pieces of the doctor and the jet flying in from Trinity Air and picking me up and flying me into Miami. Some of that began to get a little bit foggy because they had given me some Percocet.
I was told by the doctor on the jet that he felt that his foot and possibly leg was compromised at that point. They said they were gonna take him back in surgery in Miami and came out and said that a lot of other traumas had happened. They couldn't get him back, but that his leg, that he was gonna keep the leg. And so I knew that if they pushed him back, that he was gonna be all right.
But I was definitely confident at that point in time that I was gonna live, because if they put you on hold, you're not showing signs of imminent death in the near future. I had some great surgeons that took care of me. They were saying 6 months before I would be running and back to sort of normal again, minimum. And I'm a firm believer in the power of prayer and what prayer can do. Maybe 65 or 70 days from the time that I was bitten, and I can run, I can jump on one foot. I'm 100% back to feeling good.
God taught us so much about Him being faithful through every step of the shark attack and every provision that He had in place.
You may experience some trials. The Christian life is not a walk through daisies and lilies with Skittles falling from the sky and everything's rainbows. The scripture that came to me was that all things work together for good to those who love God and are called according to His purposes, and that He is who He says He is, that the Lord is God, and that He is sovereign, and that He is in charge, and He is in control, and He does have you and can take care of you.
I've learned that God is faithful regardless of the outcome, and I've learned to trust Him. Being scared, it makes me not want to take anything for granted. It makes me thankful for the gift that the Lord's given me in Him.
Wow, Eric faced the nightmare scenario, didn't he? A shark attack. It's what some of us dread when we walk into the ocean. He endured it, and somehow, in the midst of that, you heard him as he was just moments after the attack saying, I don't even know why I was saying it, but I was saying, thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. And certainly that goes contrary to what we may want to express in the midst of crisis or emergency or an urgency that we have for healing or rescue from God. But he found a way to say, thank you, Lord. And in our lives, it gets our view off of our circumstances, off of our trouble, back onto the God who loves us. And it changes our entire perspective. If you enjoy the stories and teachings that you see on our show, you'll like our new website, 700clubinteractive.com. On our website, you can send us prayer requests or ask a question that you'd like to see answered on the show. Just click the Contact Us button. You can also interact with us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Just look for us under 700 Club Interactive. Speaking of Facebook, we've received some requests on our page, so let's go back over to Jessica.
Well, Andrew, here's one from Marilyn. She says, I am unable to work outside the home due to MS. Please pray for a complete healing and a financial miracle. Sky writes, please pray for me to get a job. It's been almost a year now. I am a single mom with three kids. It's so hard, I attempted suicide. Thankfully, God not only brought me out of it, but I am back in church and doing much better, loving the Lord with all my heart and believing for a breakthrough soon. And finally, we have Barbara, who says, I pray that my son will accept Jesus and find his faith in God. He and I were alone for so many years, it's like he built a wall. I pray God breaks down this wall. Well, we are going to pray for you, and if you or someone you know needs a breakthrough in their life, join with us. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, God, for the opportunity to come to your throne of grace with boldness. Father, we lift up those who are suffering with illness. Lord, we just pray for Marilyn. Lord, that you will touch her body, that you will heal her from MS. Father, we pray for Barbara's son who is looking for his faith. He's looking for something and meaning and purpose. Father, we do pray that you would bring down that wall in his heart, that you would be Abba, Father God to him, Father, where he may not have known the love of a father. God, we pray that he will have an encounter with you. And Lord, we lift up Sky, who's been struggling with financial problems and raising three kids alone, has even been suicidal. Lord, you know her heart. Father, we ask that you would touch her, that she would encounter you, that she would see your faithfulness to provide for your children. Father, we pray for those who are watching. Lord, we ask for intervention into their marriages. We ask for healing for their bodies. Father, we ask for divine appointments, that you will reveal yourself to them in a new way, that this would begin a new season of their lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Andrew? Right,
because there are many out there who are just fearful of what's going on in this world. They're fearful when they hear and read the news and what's going on with terrorism, and then they're trying to manage their own lives. But there's also this just great anxiety about persecution, Christians being persecuted. And we're reminded that Jesus overcame the world and that the Holy Spirit is still active and moving on this earth. And the Lord is here and close to us, and his kingdom is still mighty. And in the intricate details of our lives, Jesus cares. and he does have plans for our welfare, not for calamity, to give us a future and a hope. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. We leave you these words from the book of Hebrews. Now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. I encourage you to give us a call if you need prayer, 888-777-1999. We're always here for you. For Jessica, I'm Andrew Knox. We'll see you next time on 700 Club Interactive.